How many of you really believe he's the God of miracles? You know, it's through us. It's through us. That's how it works. Jesus said, "Let me go so that I can send the Holy Spirit so that we can be his extension. We can be imitators of God." You believe God still works miracles? Have you ever met one of those Christians that are this dispensationalists that believe that when the last apostle died, that's it? When they tell me those kind of things, or I start to get into a debate with someone like that, I just laugh because I've seen too many things to unsee it. God is doing a miraculous work. Let us not become a body that is the old 80-20. 20% of the people do 80% of the work. Let us become an extension. Let us become a movement. Let us become an army of God's miracles and God's mercies and God's love. It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood. A neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in the neighborhood with you. If you know it, join me. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. And since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please, won't you be my neighbor? Then he flips the shoe and changes the cardigan and says, hi, neighbor. Can you say neighbor? I knew you could. Does anybody remember the Reverend Fred Rogers? Does anybody remember? Did you know that Fred Rogers was given special appointment by his church to be an evangelist on broadcast television? Isn't that crazy? That was his ministry. That was his calling, was to teach children. It's such a good feeling to know you're alive. Think about how much gospel that he spread. It's such a good feeling. And when you wake up ready to say, I think I'll make a special new day. He spread the gospel in where he was at, in what he was doing. It's you I like. It's you I like. It's not the clothes you wear. I'm a child of Mr. Rogers, as many of you are. It was a show that I can remember my grandmother and I watching together, and I just thought, I want deck shoes and cardigan sweaters. Did you know that his mother made every sweater he ever wore on television? Mr. Rogers. There's a rumor that he was a Marine Corps sniper, and that's not true. I think it just was a good urban legend that made him even cooler in some people's minds. My son Corbin had a shirt that said, it's all good in the hood, and it had a picture of Mr. Rogers. This was a guy who considered every child that was watching on television his neighbor. He was going to make an impact in every home that he possibly could because he took on the gospel. He knew who he was. He took on the gospel and made it real. And made it accessible. You know, he hated television. He hated it because it was full of so much misinformation and so much contradictory things that were going on that were filling the minds of children. And he took it as his mission to change that. So, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your love, and we thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives, Lord. We thank you for the fact that we can identify our neighbors, Lord, and we can really look into our own hearts and in our own lives and recognize where we're lacking and call upon you for strength. We praise you and we thank you in the mighty blood and power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning we continue our series, Love God's Way. Our sermon this morning is entitled, Who's My Neighbor? Oh, I thought you had something that you stood up. I was like, oh, he's got, I thought you were doing an illustration for me. Like, you're my neighbor. Okay. So, if you will, check out and turn to Luke chapter 10, verse 25. Thank you. Hold up your Bibles, and as is customary, just say, word up. Even if it's digital, even if you're looking at your Bible on your phone, like many of us are. Luke chapter 10, verse 25. Now, before you dismiss this story because of the first three words, and a lawyer. So we have to remember where this is coming from. And a lawyer stood up and put him to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, What is written in the law? Now, you notice that Jesus, a lot of times, when you would ask him a question, he would flip it on you. And he'd ask you a question right back. Most of the time, I think it's because people were being sarcastic. They were trying to do what it said he was trying to do. They were trying to trap him and trick him. And he was really good at going, how do you fish? Well, what's a fish? I love the way that he would do that. And he does it to this lawyer. So he says, what's written in the law? You're a lawyer. What's written in the law? You know, don't play dumb with me. You and I both know that you're trying to trap me. Let's not be stupid. How does it read to you? So now he's asking him to interpret the law. He's asking him for himself. You're this hotshot lawyer. And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. Now, notice, what does it say in the, what does it say? The law. This guy knew this is what it said and this is it. And he said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. Real simple. He broke this thing down Mr. Rogers style. It's just what it is. But wishing to justify himself, watch this, he's being selfish again. He's trying to charge Jesus by the hour like a normal lawyer. So he's trying to stretch this out and get his retainer built up. He said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? See what he's doing? He's trying to say, well, I like the guy on my right side, but the guy on my left side, not so much. Jesus replied and said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among robbers. And they stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. And by chance, a priest was going down on that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Now understand what this is saying. The priest is passing him. And he literally crossed the street to avoid him. He saw him. He knew what was going on. But he literally went as far away from him as possible and did the old one of these jobs and pretended that he didn't see him. Right? Likewise, a Levite. Now, you remember the Levites. These guys are the royal line. He also, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. Once again, he gets passed again. But a Samaritan who was on a journey came upon him And when he saw him, he felt compassion. Now, to give you a little history here, Samaritans are not who you want to get help from. These are not people that you associate with. These are not the good people of society. But you notice that the priest and the Levite both crossed the road, and the Samaritan felt compassion and came to him and bandaged up his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them, sort of a vinaigrette type of thing. And he put him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said, "Take care of him. And whatever more you spend when I return, listen, I will repay you." He said, "Open up a tab and let me know. I don't want you to feel slighted. I don't want you to feel cheated. Don't hesitate. Whatever you need to spend to get this guy better, put it on my tab. And when I come back, I'll take care of it." Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the robber's hands? The one who showed mercy towards him. Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do the same." Go and do the same. See, at different times in our lives, we are different people in the story. Sometimes we're the robbers. Sometimes we're the ones that just beat people up and leave them for dead, whether it's emotionally, physically, psychologically, spiritually. Sometimes we're the ones that are too busy with our priestly duties. We're too busy doing the things that we think we need to do for God instead of taking the time to slow down and say, "Wait a minute." Because if you can imagine, this guy was left for dead. I don't want you just to think he got beat up. It said he was left half dead. So he is busted up. This was an unavoidable circumstance. This was something that you could not ignore. And crossing the street wasn't going to do it. He's probably screaming. He's probably wailing. Or maybe the buzzards are already coming and picking at him because he's dying. Sometimes we're that priest that goes, "I got to get going. I got other stuff that I got to do." Sometimes we're the Levite that knows exactly what we should do in this situation. We know what God has called us to do. We know who we are. But yet, once again, we cross that street. And sometimes we're the Samaritan who does the right thing for no reason, for no reward, and pays out of our own pocket to take care of somebody else. Maybe you identify with one of these people in the story. Maybe you don't identify at all, because maybe you're the man. You're the man that's been beat up and left for dead. You're the one that's crying out. In my own life, I was that man. And Jesus was that good Samaritan who came along and took care of me. And he paid the ultimate price. But I've also had people in my life who came along when I was beat up and half dead, who came along and stood next to me and stood beside me and said, "Look, I got this." I was praying the other day and I'm walking. As I often do, I walked through the church and I was praying and the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. And several of us in here, we've talked about there's people who truly want to see. There's people who truly want to see God's hands. They want to be God's hands. They want to love. They really come to church to do God's work and to be an extension. And then there's some people who come, and this is everywhere. There's some people who come out of their own needs being met. We talked about it on Wednesday night in our identity series. We talked about having our needs met emotionally, psychologically, spiritually, physically. And that until those needs are met, we can't truly love like Christ. And we can't be loved like Christ. We can't even receive God's love if we don't know who we are and what He thinks of us. And so, if we were truly coming to church to love our neighbor, this place would be packed. If we truly came out of an unselfish desire and we came with the one goal of loving. See, it's not about great worship. It's not about great preaching. It's not about hot donuts and fresh coffee or hot coffee and fresh donuts. Either one, whatever you like. It's about love. It's about this doctrine of love. If you want to see your life changed, if you want to see this church become a radical, just vibrant and jumping, it's about becoming love. It's about loving God's way. Have you ever noticed that when you take out that time, when somebody's beaten up and they're half dead and you take the time to enter into their lives, especially a stranger, it's mind-blowing. Because in today's society, that's not normal. When you take the time to invite somebody to church and you really mean it, to the point you say, I'll pick you up, it changes people's lives. I would venture to say that most of you in this building are here because someone invited you. Even if it was 40 years ago, you're here because someone reached out to you. Somehow you knew this was where, and I love when people come in and they say, I just felt at home. I just felt God's love. But let me tell you something, sometimes we miss it. Sometimes I'll talk to visitors and they'll say, nobody really greeted me. Nobody really made me feel welcome. Now, that's few and far between, but it still rips my heart out. Because all in all, isn't that what are we here for? So why do we come to church? In my own life, I can be honest and I can admit that at times, when I was young, I came to church to be loved, not to love others. My home life as a kid was not so loving, and so I would go to a church that was so loving, and I would ride across town. I would get onto the, I'm from a big metropolitan area of Phoenix, Arizona, where as a child, I would get 60 cents and I could ride the bus all day long. And most people who have never been in that environment would never let their 8 and 9 year old kid get on a city bus and just ride. It's unheard of. It's crazy to think that you could go boost 60 cents from your brother's piggy bank and you could ride all day long. Sometimes my home life would be so dysfunctional that you could get a transfer. And a transfer was this little piece of paper that the bus driver would rip and give you, and it had a time on it. And somehow, sometimes, those bus drivers would look at me and they would know, this kid needs a bigger transfer. And they had a time on it. And so if they were only giving you 3 hours, it would be this big. But if they were giving you all day, they'd give you one that was this big. And I can remember this one bus driver in my neighborhood would rip off the whole transfer and he'd wink at me and he'd give me that, like, come home when you need to. And so I would drive from my poor area of town on this bus to the more affluent area, the nicer area. And I found this church where when I would go in there, for some strange reason, they loved me. They loved me in spite of me. They loved me not because of who I was or what family I was from. They loved me because they saw a kid who was beat up and left half dead that needed somebody just to love him. unconditionally, unmistakably, people loved me like Christ. I wasn't their physical neighbor, but I was their Mr. Rogers neighbor. I was the kid who needed somebody to just say, it's going to be all right. And you know, sometimes that's all it takes, is getting into somebody's world just long enough for them to understand you get it. Just long enough to put your hand out there and touch. Because sometimes that's all people need. I tell my kids constantly, let's disconnect to reconnect. Let's disconnect from all the junk. Let's disconnect from all the electronics and all the things that are sucking the life out of us. And let's just reconnect for just a minute. Let's disconnect from our own needs and our own selfish desires and our own to-do list to reconnect with people. And if you look for opportunities, you'll find them everywhere you go. When's the last time you just struck up a conversation about God with a stranger? For no reason. People out in the world who don't know Jesus are searching for love God's way, and most of them don't even know that that's what they're looking for. They don't even realize that's what they're looking for. The God love inside of you, the love that you've received from the Father, all people are doing is crying out for you to share that with them. And they don't even know it. And if you would just take just a moment to let some of that leak out, the rivers of living water that are inside of you, if we don't let that water rush out, it becomes a cesspool. Have you ever been to a waste lagoon? Not many places have them anymore, but I used to work in group homes and orphanages and these places that we don't call them orphanages anymore. That's a negative word. But these group homes, and they would have these, what looked like a really beautiful pond that you could swim in, and we would take people on tours, and we would go, oh, no, that's a waste. That's wastewater. That's a waste lagoon. Now, I don't know about you, but waste is a good way of saying that's disgusting. That is putrid. And that's the way that these rivers of living water work. If we don't let that spill out of our belly, if we don't let the love of God and the love and the compassion that Christ showed to us when we were half dead on the street, and when everybody passed us, if we don't let that water out, it becomes stagnant. It just sits there and flies start to accumulate, and it starts to be disgusting. You ever notice the difference between a rushing river and then an area that sort of gets blocked off by a fallen tree, and it's got the scum and the muck and all the nastiness on top? When I was a kid, I spent summers in Kentucky, and we had my grandfather had 22 acres, and he had this creek, and when the rains would come, the creek would go crazy. But every once in a while, you'd come, and you'd find these swimming holes, and if you've never grown up in the country, you don't know what a swimming hole is, and a swimming hole is insane, because sometimes the creek might only be 2 or 3 feet deep, but the swimming hole seems to go forever. It just seems like it's 100 feet deep. And so we would dare each other to jump into these swimming holes. But the worst dare was when someone dared you to jump into one of these cesspool areas. Because when you jumped into that nasty water and you came out and you could smell it, and it seemed like even when you jumped back into the clean, fresh, flowing water, that you just felt nasty. Have you ever been around a Christian, a professing Christian, someone who says they're a believer that when you're around them, you just feel nasty? You just feel like you got stank on you. I don't want that. I don't want to be somebody that literally you just feel just gross. How can the love of Christ be in us and operating through us if we just fix our face on just anger or disdain? Have you ever met those people that you just don't even want to go ask them anything because it's just like, oh gosh, this is just going to be, no matter what it is, do you mind moving your car 2 feet because you've blocked me in and it's just World War III? See, people out in the world who don't understand what we understand about God's love, they're looking for us. They're looking for us. Because if we don't show them God's love, who's going to? Turn to Romans chapter 13, verse 8. Owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. For this you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And if there is any other commandment, it is summed up in saying, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. You hear people all the time say, well, I'm not under the law. I'm under grace. A lot of people call it hyper grace. I'm not under the law, I'm under grace. No, that's not what it says. It says that Christ did not come to abolish the law or put aside a law or destroy the law. He came to fulfill it. That's why when they ask, what's the greatest commandment? He says, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you were to do just those two things, it would fulfill everything else. Amen? Would you kill if you were loving your neighbor? Would you steal if you were loving your neighbor? If you were loving God with all your heart and your mind and your soul and your strength, would you keep the Sabbath? Would you worship false idols? See how easy it is? It's Mr. Rogers easy. He made this thing super simple, yet because we don't know who we are in Christ, sometimes the Bible is just words. If we don't apply those words and allow them to live in us, it doesn't work. Love your neighbor as yourself is a commandment. It's a must. It is the simplest form of loving God's way. There's an old song from an old show called Cheers. And it goes like this. Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name. And they're always glad you came. You want to be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You want to go where everybody knows your name. Doesn't that sound? That's a show about a bar. That's a show about adulterous affairs and all this garbage. But doesn't that sound like what the mission of the church should be? You want to go where people know that troubles are all the same. You want to go where everybody knows your name. You ever been to one of those places where you wear the hi, my name is? Hello, my name is Roger. Hello, my name is Rodney. Or hello, my name is Rupert. Whatever our name applies to you. I don't know. But have you ever been to one of those places? If people are still jerks, "Hello, my name is Rodney," doesn't really help. Right? Just because you can say, "Hey, Rodney, you're a jerk," does that make you feel any more accepted or any more friendly or any more loved? But imagine a place where when you come in, people light up. They're excited to see you. You want to go where people know that troubles are all the same. That nobody looks at you because of the color of your sin. Nobody looks at you like, "Well, she's a little more putrid than I am, so that I'm not even going to associate with her. He's a little filthier than I am. He's done more wrong than I've done." When did that become the standard? "Well, at least I'm not as bad as so-and-so." What? Where does that sound like that you're dying to your flesh and becoming alive to Christ? Where? This is garbage. We've taken on this stuff that's just ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Everybody wants to feel significant. Everyone wants to know that you care that they're there. That's how things change. That's how things get better. That's how things improve. Is when you take the time out to notice that somebody's half dead and beaten up on the side of the road. Loving God's way is loving your neighbor. Check out and turn to Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 through 18. "For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything." So Christ is the head of the body, which is the church. We all agree, correct? Christ is the head. If Christ is the head of the church, why do we speak for him things that aren't Christ? Why do we push Christ out of the way and be his mouthpiece of nonsense? If your love looks or smells or tastes or appears or seems or even sort of kind of looks like hate, it's not love. It's not love. And we all know love is patient, love is kind. If you forget what love looks like, there's a whole chapter. They call it the love chapter. Millions of weddings all over the world, they read this. Love is patient, love is kind. It doesn't delight in evil. It keeps no record of wrong. I tell young people all the time, if you really want to press in and really love and you really want to, I used to say it constantly, replace the word love with your own name. Rodney is patient. Rodney is kind. Exactly. If you can't say those things about yourself, then it's time to check yourself. It's time to start to evaluate what love looks like in your life. So if Christ is the head of the body, what are you? Check out and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. "For even as the body is one and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, They're one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot says, because I'm not a hand, I am not part of the body, it is not for this reason any the less a part of the body. And if the ear says, because I am not an eye, I am not part of the body, it is not for this reason any the less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where should the sense of smell be? But now God has placed the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he desired. If they were all one member, where would the body be? But now there are many members, but one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Or again, go back one, I'm sorry. You're faster than I am this morning. I have no need of you. Or again, the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, it is much truer that the members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we deem less honorable, on those we bestow more abundant honor, and our less presentable members become much more presentable. Whereas our more presentable members have no need of it. But God has so composed the body, giving more abundant honor to that member which lacked. So that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are Christ's body and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, administration, various kinds of tongues. All are not apostles, are they? All are not prophets, are they? All are not teachers, are they? All are not workers of miracles. All do not have the gifts of healings, do they? All do not speak with tongues, do they? All do not interpret, do they? But earnestly desire the greater gifts, and I show you still a more excellent way. So here we are as a body. We all are playing a part. You may see things that you don't understand. You may want the things that other people have, and it says to seek out those things. But we have to figure out our created value. We have to figure out who we are as a member of the body. Because if we don't even know if we're a pinky finger or an appendix, there's a big difference. We have to know who we are. We have to figure out how we fit and function in this body, in the body of Christ as a whole. In this church, in this community, we have to figure out who we are. And we have to become the greatest version of ourselves. Because God has placed inside of you the gifts, God has placed inside of you the abilities that you don't even know exist. And there are people out there that you are called to reach that I or anyone else isn't going to have the same effect. There are people that God has placed in your lives that you're crossing the street and you're ignoring. And all it would take was you stepping into their lives for just a moment and saying, let me help. Check out and turn to John chapter 13, verse 34. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, so that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Love your neighbor in such a way that that person can't help but know you are a disciple of Christ. If you've never had that happen to you, if you've never had somebody say, "Why are you doing this?" It's the greatest feeling in the world to say, "It's Jesus." Not, "I'm a nice guy." Not, "I had some extra denarii that I could just part with and put you up in a hotel for a couple of days and have the doctor come and do a house call." Not that, but just to say, "Look, I am my Father's, and He is mine, and He's loved me, so I want to love you. I want you to understand what you mean to God." That's a game changer. Explaining God's love in such a way that it floors people and their jaw drops, that's a game changer. That's the moment in someone's life that years later, when they give the testimony, they're going to go, "This guy, this woman just loved me for no reason. They just loved me because they said that God loved them. It was the strangest thing." Maybe they'll remember you, maybe they won't. Who cares? When you snatch someone out of hell on earth, when you snatch someone away from the darkness that they're living in, and show them Christ's love, it's a game changer. That is loving your neighbor. The goal is to turn strangers into neighbors, turn neighbors into friends, and turn friends into family. It's a process, loving your neighbor. It's not easy, but nothing good is. If everyone could hit a home run, it wouldn't be amazing. If everyone could throw a Super Bowl winning touchdown with seconds left on the clock, it wouldn't be amazing. If everyone could walk on water and take the time to put their hand out and help the one who took their eyes off, it wouldn't be Jesus. It wouldn't be spectacular. Mr. Rogers spent his career on television as a minister asking, "Won't you be my neighbor?" Maybe this morning we can get a little Mr. Rogers of our own. So what can we do as a church body to ask that question? What can we do to love our neighbor? I promise you, if you keep your eyes open, God will reveal those things to you. And they might be simple. They might be as simple as seeing a need and filling it. So what can we do in this body to be more unified? What can we do to make sure that when people come in here, they feel like this is a place where everybody knows their name? This is a place where when I come into this place, I know that I'm not going to get beat up. That I can drop the walls on my heart. That I don't have to keep my hands up. I can just drop my hands down and let people love me. So who is your neighbor? Let God reveal that. It's easy to just say everybody, but if we don't get specific, we're just going to throw it away. Don't live off the old stuff. Let's get some of the new stuff. So listen, with every head bowed and every eye closed this morning, no one's looking around, nobody's making any commotions. Let's just get real for just a minute. If you have never accepted Christ as your Savior, and you're that guy on the road that's beat up and bleeding, the Good Samaritan is here this morning. If that's you this morning and you're ready to start that journey to being accepted by Christ and accepting Christ, will you just lift up your hand this morning? Maybe it's you in here. Maybe it's you that says, listen, I've been far away. I've gotten a little off track. And if this morning you need to rededicate your life to Christ, would you just slip up your hand for me? If you're ready to get real about being real, if you're ready to step into who God says that you are, maybe you feel 100 million miles away, but listen, today is your day to get that right. If that's you, would you just slip up your hand? Please don't leave this place. Whether you raise your hand or not, don't leave this place the same way that you came in. If you need our prayer team to pray for you, these altars are always open. I don't care if it's in the middle of my message. If God is calling you and God is spurring you and God is pulling at your heart, don't wait. Heavenly Father, right now, I just pray that you would just comfort each person in this place, that you would renew their created value in them. Father, that you would bless their socks off, letting them feel the love that you showed to us by sending your Son Jesus. We praise you. We thank you for everything that you've done this morning. We thank you, Father God, that you've allowed us to handle business this morning through worship. That you've allowed us to handle business this morning through prayer and through the altar, Father. And we just thank you, Father, that we would learn how to love more like you by loving our neighbor. We praise you for everything that you've done. Saturate us with your Holy Spirit. Cover us by your blood as we leave this place. And we thank you for it in Jesus' mighty and powerful name. And all God's people said, amen.